Men and women of Ireland, it's an honour for me to be here this morning on this special occasion to honour Pádraig hAinle, August Eugene O'Connell, who was buried in St. Joseph's. We start off now with a minute's silence for the brave volunteers. Agusinish and Reed. Agusinish Tomás.
The Corgi Gael. We're here today to commemorate the lives of two Irish volunteers, Fianna member Pádraig hAinle and IRA volunteer Eugene O'Connell, both who lived in the Broad Street area, Middle Parish in Cork City. The two volunteers had quite different backgrounds. Hanley was just 17 years of age and was a highly active member of Fianna Éireann. His father had died when he was young, and Hanley worked as a labourer since a child to support his mother. In contrast, O'Connell was 28 years of age, a former British soldier who had just returned from the English battle against Germany in Europe, and he lived with his wife and child at 17 Broad Lane. On the 17th of November 1920, just before midnight, the RIC in Cork City went on a murder rampage in search of a group of IRA volunteers who had successfully killed a Sergeant O'Donoghue, who was a leading figure within the RIC in Cork, who was trying to suppress the independence movement. On the night of O'Hanley's and O'Connell's murder, the RIC arrived in the Broad Street area seeking revenge for the assassination of O'Donoghue. They had information suggesting that the IRA volunteers who carried out the killing lived in the Middle Parish. Below Pádraig Hanley's household lived the Coleman family. Mrs. Stephen Coleman described the events in the night as a man broke open her front door and charged up the stairs, burst into her and her husband's bedroom and shot her husband dead. The men were wearing uniforms, caps and goggles. The same gunmen then proceeded up the stairs where they shot Pádraig Hanley dead with a bullet just above his heart. Pádraig Hanley was a Fianna scout within the city. Another IRA volunteer who had witnessed the murder, Leo Buckley, an officer in the 2nd Battalion, gave a vivid account of the event, saying, "By peering out my back window, I was able to look into the back rooms of a house on Broad Street, and I saw two men mounting the stairs. They wore RIC caps and grey coats, and they had motor goggles on their faces. They entered the rooms on the first floor, and I saw both of them open fire on the second. I saw both of them open fire on the people in bed, Stephen Coleman and his wife. I heard a woman scream. Then they mounted to the second floor, and the flash lamps they used as they climbed the stairs gave me a good picture of them. They entered the back room on the second floor, and I distinctly heard a young boy's voice saying, 'Oh God, sir, don't shoot me.' Both men opened fire, and several bullets were sent into young Hanley's body. Buckley was convinced that Hanley had been shot, as he had been mistaken for volunteer Thomas Healy, who had been involved in the assassination of Sergeant O'Donoghue. In the same house as Hanley lived volunteer William Joe O'Brien, who is Hanley's brother-in-law. His young brother Charles, who was 16 years of age and was active in the Fianna with Pádraig Hanley, was also gravely wounded that night when the RIC opened fire on him. The O'Briens and the O'Hanleys were strong Republican families. The headline in the Cork Examiner the following morning stated, "Thou shall not kill." What the editor reported, it seems to be the case that the shooting of Sergeant O'Donoghue was the impelling motive that secured vengeance in the killing of three other citizens, in dangerously wounding two others, and in the unbridled display of frightfulness which took the form of indiscriminate firing in the public unlighted streets during the early hours of darkness on Thursday morning, the 18th of November. The murder of volunteers Eugene O'Connell and Eugene O'Connell were very similar in nature. A relative of O'Connell stated, "The killer broke open the door at 17 Broad Lane, and a man in uniform and wearing goggles, he had a revolver in his right hand and a flash lamp in the other. He rushed straight up the stairs where he shot O'Connell dead in his bedroom, in the presence of his wife. The gunman then charged up another flight of stairs and shot Fianna scout Charles O'Brien, 16, with a bullet passing through his mouth and jaw. The murder of O'Connell took place a few minutes after the murder of Pádraig hAinle. At the Military Court of Inquiry, Mrs. O'Connell testified that the gunman who had killed her husband wore a long overcoat, a policeman's cap, and had a revolver in one hand and a flash lamp in the other. She said her husband crawled into the bedroom after being wounded, with the RIC officers still firing upon them. She was in bed with her baby, and a man raised a revolver at her, and she shouted for mercy for the baby's sake. The bodies of Fianna member Pádraig hAinle and Eugene O'Connell were taken to the Mercy Hospital just after midnight, where both were pronounced dead and were laid out in the mortuary at the hospital. Large crowds gathered in pilgrimage to the scene of the murder and to say prayers for the three men killed in the night by the RIC. O'Hanley and O'Connell had a joint removal from the Mercy Hospital to St. Peter's and Paul's Church, where the Fianna put on a huge display for O'Hanley. However, this is where there was a distinction within the two families, and although they had a joint removal, the funerals took place separately. O'Hanley's coffin was draped with the tricolour, and four of his Fianna comrades carried a coffin, while a further six Fianna volunteers formed a guard of honour. All were dressed in uniform. The different companies of the Fianna in Cork City and County formed a guard of honour along the route of both the removal and the funeral, and paraded behind the coffin to St. Finbar Cemetery. On the coffin was the Irish tricolour and O'Hanley's scout hat. The volunteer pipe band led the funeral, and he was laid to rest in the Republican plot just here behind us, only days after the internment of hunger strikers Terence McSweeney and Joseph Murphy. In contrast, while Eugene O'Connell had joined the IRA and was involved in the arms training and the acquisition of weapons, his family were not Republican. His father, two of his uncles, and two of his brothers had all served in the British Army. O'Connell's remains were taken to St. Joseph's Cemetery on the same day, with ex-British Army servicemen marching behind his coffin, which bore no Republican paraphernalia. The IRA response to the murder of O'Hanley and O'Connell was swift, and in the next few days, they had shot a further three RIC members in Cork City. And further to this as well, the IRA, in investigation into the deaths of O'Hanley, had discovered an informer in the rank, which led then to discovery of the anti-Sinn Féin Society in Cork. And this was a society set up by loyalists for the specific assassination of Republicans, especially Sinn Féin TDs and councillors, and it was targeting people who were involved in the organisation of the independence movement, deliberately aiming to trash the independence of this country. And this is the same group that operated in the Civil War, trying to sow mistrust between Irish Republicans and those who went Free State. And it's very likely it is the anti-Free State, or the anti-Sinn Féin Society, that was involved in the murder of TD Sean Hales, as Republicans had always denied any involvement in that murder. Just also on the note of the Fianan, or the Fianna, Fianna Éireann at the time, of which Pádraig O'Hanley had been a member, without the Fianna, there would never have been the Irish volunteer movement. The Fianna had been set up in 1909, but when the volunteers had been set up in 1913, it was the young Fianna men who were just then becoming of age in their early, some of them 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, they became the officers of the Irish volunteers. And they were the ones who were drilling, who were teaching the volunteers how to use weapons, and who were teaching them about signaling and so forth. And they were the ones who built the volunteer movement. And we know in Cork we had Fianna members like Leo Murphy, who at the age of 19 took over the 3rd Battalion area, and who was any bit as successful as any of the other leading flying column members throughout Cork and throughout Ireland. So we're just here, and we'd like to thank everyone for coming. We'd like to pay tribute to the men and women who gave their lives for Irish independence during the struggle for independence in the 1920s, and especially to pay tribute to Pádraig O'Hanley and Eugene O'Connell. Very minimal. Thank
you, Tomás.
Eddie has booklets there for sale and information on your heritage. I'd invite everybody to buy them.